Welcome back, explorers. Brian here, your guide to our journey around the world. And today we really will be traveling around the world, many times over. You'd better buckle your seatbelt because by my calculations, that's pretty fast. Just kidding. Today we'll be traveling around the world on paper. We'll explore the main tool used by geographers to convey information: maps. The road map for today's lesson includes the learning goals: describe map-making history, describe the three main categories of maps and explain what they are used for, and apply knowledge of basic map features, including a key, scale, and compass rose. We'll start today by returning to a mental image we explored in our What is Geography lesson. Imagine how the world must have looked to ancient people. There were no phones, no computers, no Google Earth. They traveled primarily by walking. If they ventured out a few miles from where they lived, they might encounter something dangerous or something wonderful, but there was no way to know what to expect. How could they know what's out there beyond what's already familiar to them? And how could they record what they discovered and share this information with others? One way to do it, they found, was to make maps. A map is a picture or chart that emphasizes the relationships between elements within a particular space. It might show cities, roads, rivers, or other physical features. It might show stars, ocean depth, or even just the various points of interest in your neighborhood. In any case, visualizing what's around us by communicating spatial relationships between things has become very useful. The first known people to create a map of their surroundings were the Babylonians of ancient Mesopotamia. This map, from 600 BCE, carved into a tablet, shows the ancient city of Babylon on the banks of the Euphrates River, along with several other cities, all surrounded by a circular sea and islands beyond. It wasn't just the Babylonians. Greeks and Romans were curious enough to gather data and make maps as well. Scholars of ancient India proposed theories about the makeup of the Earth's crust, and by the 4th century CE, Indian geographers were compiling written descriptions of the people, regions, and climates of the territory where they lived and traveled. In China, geographers compiled a book of documents as early as the 5th century BCE that described the rivers, lakes, soil, and goods produced in the 9 provinces of ancient China. These, and the more modern tools we learned about previously, are used to compile data that helps paint detailed, colorful pictures of our changing world. No matter what form that detailed, colorful picture takes, whether it's a satellite image or GIS visualization, it's really just a map. Maps are geographic tools serving a very practical purpose, but let's not forget that they can also be beautiful and historically significant. This map, called the Universalis Cosmographia, was created by a German mapmaker in 1507. It's known as America's birth certificate because it was the first map to recognize the continent of America, which the mapmaker named after the explorer Amerigo Vespucci. Because of its historical significance, this map, which resides in the Library of Congress, is widely considered one of the most valuable maps in the world. Here's another called Leo Belgicus, made in 1611, artfully depicting the European lands known today as Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands. Why do you think this mapmaker took an artistic approach while creating this map? Pause the video and respond in your PDF. Sometimes mapmakers, also known as cartographers, were so protective of the design of their maps that they would include fake locations or paper towns on their maps to catch copycats. A famous example of this is Agloe, New York, a paper town invented by an American map company in the 1930s to thwart copyright infringement. Agloe didn't exist, yet the town appeared on that company's maps for decades and became so famous that it's now a real-life landmark. What does it suggest about the value of maps, given that people feel the need to protect the design of the maps they make? Cartographers have to work pretty hard to create these maps in the first place. A lot of time goes into making them, and they are incredibly useful to the people that use them. Of course, they're valuable. Most maps fall into three basic categories: physical, political, and special purpose. Physical maps highlight the physical features of a particular area, like mountains, rivers, or deserts. Political maps show features determined by people, such as national boundaries, state lines, and capital cities. Special purpose maps show very specific data, like population density, the ridges of the mountain you're hiking on, global flight patterns, or imminent weather events. Let's take a second to consider the value in these different designs. Is it good to be able to convey different kinds of information about places that appear on maps? Take a minute and respond in your lesson guide. Maps also have some basic components that help make sense of their contents: the key, the scale, and the directional indicator. The directional indicator, also known as a compass rose, indicates where the cardinal directions, north, south, east, and west, lie on a map. The legend, or key, explains the symbols used on a map. What does this color represent according to the key on this map? Yes, it means that this area receives between 0 and 0.1 inches of snowfall each year. Bummer! No snow days. And what about this symbol? That's right, it identifies the Washington Monument as an iconic site and shows its location. A map's key unlocks some really cool potential for showing all sorts of interesting things about different locations. Like this one, which shows which side of the road people drive on around the world, and whether they measure distance and speed using miles or kilometers. A map's scale provides a ratio between distances on a map and actual distances on Earth. A map scale of 1 to 250,000, for example, means that every centimeter on the map equals 250,000 centimeters, or 2.5 kilometers on the ground. Latitude and longitude are imaginary lines that form a grid covering the globe. This global grid helps identify locations anywhere on Earth. Lines of latitude, also known as parallels, run east to west around the globe, with the equator at 0 degrees and the poles at 90 degrees north and south. Lines of longitude, also known as meridians, run from pole to pole crossing the parallels. The prime meridian is at 0 degrees east. The international date line is exactly on the other side of the globe, which means that the meridians do not go all the way around the Earth like the parallels do. If you were to use a map app on your phone and enter the coordinates 48.8584 degrees north for latitude and 2.2945 degrees east for longitude, you'd pinpoint the exact location of the Eiffel Tower in Paris. Pretty cool, huh? Since the ancient Babylonians, humans have aimed to make visualizations of the world to communicate what they know about the world to each other. With each map, we are better able to write about the world, literally graphing it in some form for each other. As we continue our journey as geographers in this course, we encourage you to practice using the tools we learned today. Remember to ask questions, be curious, and keep exploring. Hey, hey.